A young girl and her friends frolic on a paved road outside an elegant mansion. The mother of one of the girls peers through luxurious drapes out the window. Tourists pass by, visiting the famed town of Pompeii, there to experience the bustling taverns and elaborate bathhouses, the busy cafes and acclaimed artisan stalls. Hundreds of others mingle in the market square or head to the giant arena, and meanwhile, the many slaves of the town clean floors, work in factories, or massage men in the local wolf den. Then, suddenly, a deafening crack is heard, followed by great plumes of ash blackening the sky. Those people in the streets see daytime turn to night. People soon scream in the darkness as buildings collapse around them. Noxious gases and superheated rocks will envelop them all. That's what happened the day the Roman city of Pompeii was swallowed, when something like 12 to 20,000 folks were stopped in their tracks, consumed by nature's whim. How we know the scene was something close to that is because many, many years later, archaeologists managed to put the pieces back together. But before we can get to what they discovered, let's have a closer look at Pompeii in ancient times. The city, which today lies in the province of Naples, Italy, was home to people from present-day Italy as far back as the 8th century BC. We'll make this part quick and just tell you that the ancient Greeks landed there, and in 6th century BC it became a place with flourishing trade. City walls were constructed and temples were built, and over a period of a few hundred years Pompeii enriched itself through trade and agriculture. Wealthy people would flock there after hearing about this beautiful town, marked with grand private buildings, theaters, bathhouses, and marvelous statues saluting the gods. Not long before the cataclysmic eruption destroyed the city in its entirety in 79 AD, it was renowned as a place where rich Roman men could lavish themselves on fine wines and the many women that worked in the brothels. Being right on the sea, it would attract wealthy tourists, so you might say Pompeii was to some extent a resort town. But overlooking the city was something that made itself aware on occasion to the people of Pompeii, and that was the great Mount Vesuvius. We say made aware because the thing would rumble from time to time, noted by some Roman authors. The Romans actually thought that this mount was divine, giving it a mythological meaning which was later discovered in mural paintings called frescoes. What the Romans didn't know was that Pompeii itself stood on a lava plateau that had been created by an eruption of this volcano. The people should have been worried, and they got a taste of what was to come when around 17 years before most of them would die, they experienced an earthquake that caused considerable damage in Pompeii and beyond. The ensuing years saw a lot of reconstruction of damaged buildings, while other edifices were erected. Things were getting back to normal. Let's now get to that bad day in the life of Pompeii. We know something about how it went down because a Roman author named Pliny the Younger wrote about the catastrophe. His uncle, Pliny the Elder, had actually died while trying to evacuate people from the town. It's thought the eruption happened sometime in October or November. Pliny wrote that on this day, a great plume of smoke was seen rising from the mountain. He actually described it like this: "Its general appearance can best be expressed as being like an umbrella pine, for it rose to a great height on sort of a trunk and then split off into branches." His uncle at the time was not in the town, but not far away. He realized that what he had seen was an event of great magnitude, and so he called his men and set off to help. The uncle got to the shore next to the city. It was there, it seems, he choked to death, according to his nephew anyway. Pliny wrote to the great Roman historian Tacitus about the eruption. This is what he recalls of the second day of the disaster and what happened to him and his mother. Pliny wrote that he heard women screaming, infants crying, people feeling their way through the darkness, looking for lost relatives, praying. In his own words, he said, "Many besought the aid of the gods, but still more imagined there were no gods left, and that the universe was plunged into eternal darkness forevermore." He was right, too. There was to be eternal darkness for the people of Pompeii, but they would experience some kind of resurrection. Some of them are now being photographed by tourists with smartphones, but we'll talk more about that soon. It was first thought that the people, well, most of them, would have died from ash inhalation. No doubt a lot did succumb that way, but most perished not from ash, but from heat. You see, when Vesuvius erupted, it ejected something called pyroclastic surges. These surges happened 6 times in total. What happens in these surges is incredibly hot ash along with toxic gases are spewed out, and those travel at incredibly fast speeds. Vesuvius might be located 10 miles from the town, but the surges could have traveled at 100 miles per hour. The people really didn't have anywhere to run. Scientists now say inside or outside, when these surges happened, the temperature would have been around 570 degrees Fahrenheit, and people would have been killed on the spot. We also know that some of the people died as if frozen in suspended actions. One researcher said this, The contorted postures are not the effects of a long agony, but of the cadaveric spasm, a consequence of heat shock on corpses. When it all calmed down and the city was destroyed along with its inhabitants, robbers arrived on the scene. Pompeii wasn't completely buried, although those thieves did have to dig through some ash to find their bounty. Those guys looted from the deceased, but after that, for many centuries, Pompeii was dead to the world. It no longer existed. The place that had suffered the wrath of the gods was left to itself. In the 16th century, some city walls were discovered decorated with frescoes, but it wasn't until the early 19th century that it was realized after some excavations that there must have been some great city that once occupied the area. The ashes had perfectly preserved the city and some of the people to some extent. It was as if they were frozen in time. So what did they find? The most incredible thing was just how well built this place was. They discovered what you might call a state-of-the-art Roman amphitheater, along with a gymnasium with a swimming pool. They found public baths, theaters, cafes, factories, markets, and even an area dedicated to brothels. Wait a minute, how would they know a place could have been a house where rich Romans went to sow their seed? Well, it's the same reason they know what else was there. The Romans designed places for a specific intention. A brothel was called lupanar, which means wolf den. Pompeii's wolf den was credited as being a grand lupanar. In the den, excavators found walls covered with erotic paintings as well as graffiti that had been transcribed. It explains what went on inside those walls. One such bit of graffiti actually reads, "Upila was here with 2,000 beautiful men." We won't tell you what else they found because we don't want to make this an X-rated show, but suffice it to say, it doesn't seem that lewd graffiti has changed very much in 2,000 and a bit years. They also discovered that Pompeii was served by an aqueduct which delivered water to private dwellings as well as bathhouses, the swimming pool, and the 25 water fountains in the city. They could see how the crops were cultivated and how wine was produced, what foods the people must have eaten, and what some people might have done for business. As for those bodies, you can see people crouching down and looking like they're praying. Others are mid-crawl, some are huddled together. We should say that these whole-looking bodies are casts that were made from impressions of bodies in the ash. The skeletons were surrounded by voids of ash, and so plaster of Paris was poured into the voids. They represent how the body would have looked, but aren't actually the body. The stone people are creations or representations. Most would have been killed by those searches we talked about, but others might have succumbed from choking on ash, or from roofs falling on them, or from flying rocks. Some lucky others might have gotten away because no boats have ever been found. 13 bodies were found in what was called the Garden of the Fugitives, which must have been a kind of fruit farm. The House of Mysteries is home to 9 bodies, and it's thought a roof might have fallen on those folks. One person was just chilling in a tavern when he died, while others were at the baths and others in the market. There are even casts of animals such as a dog and a pig. It's all the erotic stuff that's really given us insight into the private lives of the rich Romans, and there was quite a haul. Unfortunately, some of it was destroyed in the 19th century by people who were too prudish to allow Roman sexuality to be seen. Other parts of this collection were locked in what was called a secret cabinet. Thanks to these, pieces of art are now open for public viewing. Thanks to CT scans, we also know a bit more about the health of the people that died. One thing we know is that many of the people had great teeth, and that's because they had a good diet. Not much sugar and lots of fiber. You might wonder what we'll look like if we're dug up in 1,000 years. And this segues nicely to the next part. Because what's perhaps frightening is that Mount Vesuvius is now surrounded by around 600,000 people who live in what's called a danger zone. About 3 million people live close enough to be affected if that thing should go off again. It's actually the most densely populated area in the entire world where an active volcano is present. But what are the chances of another eruption happening anytime soon? Well, it last went off in 1944, not long after the Allies invaded Italy. Again, ash filled the skies and rocks rained down on nearby villages. As if the war wasn't enough, those folks were having to put up with violent vagaries of nature. People fled their houses as lava approached. Vesuvius has popped its lid on many occasions, and there were eruptions in the 1600s, 1700s, and 1800s, which saw explosions of ash and gas and flows of lava. In 1631, after an eruption, thousands of people died. In 1944, most of the townfolk got away quickly enough. 26 died. In 1906, residents weren't that fortunate, and over 100 people died. It devastated nearby villages and also Naples. These days, if Vesuvius went off and you were one of the 600,000 plus people living in the red zone, you could be in big trouble. The red zone consists of people living in a 9-mile radius of the volcano. Looking at how active this volcano has been and the period of quiet that has passed, you might think another eruption is due, and that's why it's called a time bomb. The good news is that the Italian government in the early 2000s put evacuation drills in place, and it might know better than those ancient Romans when the volcano will go off. It's being observed all the time, so that might help matters. The government even tried to relocate people, but not many folks were interested in that. Today, scientists said if Vesuvius did erupt, there would be trouble, and it's very likely it's due another eruption soon. In 2019, the volcano was put under surveillance after magma was seen pushing up to the surface. A year before that, volcanic activity was making some people very nervous, and new evacuation plans were being drawn up. It's gonna go off, it's just a matter of time. And since it's just a matter of time, you need to know what would happen to your body if you fell into a volcano. So go watch What Happens to Your Body When You Fall Into a Volcano right now. We're serious. Don't wait. The volcanoes could start going off at any time.